Most people call it Doubting Thomas Sunday, but because my baptismal name is Thomas, I call it Inquisitive Thomas, which I think is more accurate, but I will not argue with anybody about it. But it's good to see you all as we give praise to Almighty God. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Lord Jesus, make us worthy to celebrate with spiritual hymns your hands to Thomas and your apostles. You desire to strengthen the faith of your holy church by inviting Thomas to put his hand in your pure side. Strengthen our faith like his in the mystery of your glorious resurrection. Fill us with your hope and love so that we may raise glory to you, to your Father and your living Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Thank you.
accept our incense as we commemorate your appearance to your apostle, St. Thomas. As you are pleased by his faith and profession of your divinity, accept our prayers and petitions, and favorably remember all the faithful departed who have died, hoping in you, and grant them eternal rest. We raise glory and thanks to you forever.
Amen. Please stand.
We know him no longer in that way.
So if anyone is in Christ, there is a new creation. Everything old has passed away. See, everything has become new. All this is from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ, and has given us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, in Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them, and entrusting the message of reconciliation to us. So we are ambassadors for Christ. Since God is making his appeal through us, we entreat you on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. For our sake, he made him to be sin who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God.
Praise be to God always.
And the reason why this is very significant and important for us as Catholics
is because since our faith goes back to the time of the apostles, our beliefs, our structures, our form of worship, and our thoughts towards Jesus reflect not only what's written in the gospel, but also some of the things don't necessarily show up in the gospel absolutely literally. But yet, because they are there, they are aware of it, and they learn and structure their worship according to what they have personally experienced and personally have lived. And then if you read something 1,500 years later and try to redirect it and draw up exactly the way it is, it's not going to be the same. It's not going to look the same. It's just like any family, that a book written about the family isn't going to be identical with what the family tells about themselves. And so we have, certainly among the Orthodox Church and the Catholic Church, what we call holy tradition. Part of that tradition is Thomas was an apostle to India. You have the Malankar and the Malabar Rite in India. They're called the Thomistic Christians. They are a sister church in the fact that they also use Syriac. Sometimes I'll go on YouTube and listen to the Malabar or the Malankar liturgy, and I can understand some of the Syriac, listen, sing the Kadishat of the whole. I think they have lively music, but the tradition is very much the same, very similar, except for one detail that you probably would be upset about. They get to stay in church 2 hours, and we only get to stay in 1 hour. There's some wonderful, beautiful theological dimensions to reflect on. We're not absolutely certain what the glorifying body looks like, but we do know, for the example of Jesus, is that he can go through locked doors, that they were protecting themselves from people who were persecuting them, and Jesus went through the locked doors. We can also believe from this that his body is human enough, physically enough, that Thomas could put his hand into his side and his finger into his wounds. But we know there's still something different about the glorified body, because during the week, at different occasions, they didn't recognize him right away. They didn't recognize him until he celebrated the Eucharist with them a few times. Or when they came ashore and he cooked for them fish and broke bread with them. Which means these are all very important to be found in the scriptures, because every type of religion that exists has this murky sort of belief in the afterlife and ghosts and supernatural beings, that one of the things that they don't do is they don't eat. And Jesus did eat with them to make sure that they would believe in such a way that it wouldn't be just symbolic, that it wouldn't be just some murky type of ghost-like figure, or, with this story, to make sure we understand that this isn't a story that the apostles made up to attract believers. For one reason, you don't try to start up a religion when everybody's trying to arrest you. For our faith, it was 300 years before the governments and countries weren't putting Christians to death. You don't make this stuff up and keep living it for 300 years when the only thing you might get out of it is martyrdom. And then again, put it in the story about Thomas, about his doubts. That it is very human, very understandable why we might struggle with our faith, because we don't understand it completely. You know, they lived with him for 3 years, teaching, they saw miracles, they saw Lazarus brought back to life and saw the blind regain their sight. All these incredible miracles. And yet, it should be almost embarrassing that they still had their doubts. And that is because of the fall from grace. That to completely trust and surrender one's life completely to something outside of oneself, supernatural, is not easy to do. And by putting this in the gospel, we obviously see that Thomas had no intentions of just doing this just for the glory of something. That he wanted and he asked this of Jesus. Can I touch your wounds? And that is probably the most important part for us to focus on. The others are kind of like packaged paper around this particular gift. Jesus did not hide his wounds. Part of this, and we would have never guessed it, is that there would be a lot of different interpretations of who Jesus was. For some, that he never was raised from the dead, that somebody stole his body. Why should we believe this? This happened a long time ago. Or that he never died. Now, in some countries, some cultures, some governments, and some religions do personally, specifically teach that Jesus never did die. It just seemed like it, or someone who looked like him. And to discount that Jesus was the Redeemer of the world, the Son of God, who was raised from the dead. Then we come to the next part. After touching his wounds. You see, and him having those wounds still being visible, we have to realize that those are our wounds. He would never have them if our lives were perfect, if we've never been hurt. The story would not exist if we never had to deal with doubts. When we look at the crucifix and look at his wounds, we don't have to just focus on his misery and his sorrow. Even till this day, Christians still get crucified, literally. We should also realize that he is touching our wounds. Have we been hurt? Have we been pierced by sorrow and grief? Are we going through a rough time in our life, not knowing how the rest of the story is going to end in our own life or someone else's life and what they're going through? Life is still filled with unknowns. We're not absolutely certain of the safety and the health of ourselves, of our children, of our parents, of the people around us. There is uncertainty in life, and there is reason to have doubts on the human level. But we can see how he hurt, we can also see how he knows how we hurt. Because those are also our wounds. So you might want to, certainly I want to, reflect on the type of wounds that I might have in my life. What sometimes makes me a little cynical or bothered or irritated, or maybe envious or jealous. What has happened long ago in my life where I felt hurt, rejected? And what do I do with that wound? Do I still bring it up and pick at it and trying to get attention with it, trying to use it for an explanation of why I might not live up to the calling of Jesus Christ the way I am supposed to? Or do I present it before the cross? Not that he's asking us to hide our hurts or disguise them or be ashamed of them, but to let the breath of God breathe upon them. To let the sanctifying water, when we bless ourselves and we come into church, to let the wound be open enough for healing. You know, our worst suffering is what we keep a secret. Now that doesn't mean we stand up in front of the whole world with a loudspeaker and speak about it. It has to be trusted friends, the appropriate place for it. And certainly, within the prayers of the Holy Eucharist, is one of the most perfect places to present our wounds and see them in his side and see them in his hands. When we actually pray the prayers that are before us, we'll see how tenderly and mercifully and compassionately he lets us give him our wounds. And he offers us his grace, his healing, his love, his compassion. He can get through our locked doors. We might shut ourselves off so deeply, so strongly, that no one can penetrate. But the resurrected Lord, in all his power and his grace, he can pierce our heart, what we have locked up inside, and he will feel it with us. The only thing we have to do is say yes. Yes, Jesus. Yes to your power. Yes to your healing. Yes to your guidance. Yes to your victory over sin and death.
God.
have brought to you out of the love for you in your holy name. Shower your spiritual blessings upon them, and place that they are to be gifts, grant them life in your kingdom.
Amen.
As we remember our Lord God and Savior Jesus Christ and his plan of salvation for us, we recall upon this offering all those who have pleased God from Adam to this day, especially Mary, the Blessed Mother of God, St. Mary, St. Joseph, and St. Jude. Remember, O God, the children of the Holy Church, our fathers and mothers, and our brothers and sisters, both the living and the departed, especially those for whom the sacrifice is offered for prayer. Remember also those who share with us today in this offering.
Amen.
Oh,
Thomas said, My Lord and my God. the healing of souls and bodies, and the strengthening of consciences, so that none of your faithful may perish. Rather, make us worthy to live by your Spirit and lead up your light, and we raise glory to you now and forever.
Jesus.
only Son and your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
Let us bow our heads before the God of mercy, before his forgiving altar, and before the body and blood of our Savior, who is life to those who partake of him, and receive the blessing of the Lord.
O Lord, bless your faithful people who bow before you. Deliver us from all harm and make us worthy to share these divine mysteries of purity and holiness, that through them we may be forgiven and made holy, and we raise glory to you, now and forever.
Amen.
The grace of the Most Holy Trinity, eternal and constant, shall be with you, my brothers and sisters, forever.
And with your spirit.
Let each one of us look to God with reverence and humility, and ask him for mercy and compassion.
Holy gifts for the holy, with perfection, purity, and sanctity.
One holy Father, one holy Son, one holy Spirit, blessed be the name of the Lord, for it is one in heaven and on earth, to him be glory forever. Make us worthy, O Lord God, so that our bodies may be sanctified by your holy body, and our souls purified by your forgiving blood. May our communion be for the forgiveness of our sins and for life. O Lord our God, to you be glory forever.
Sacrifice.
location icon at this time. Receive the holy icon for vocations to the Maronite priesthood. May your prayers be heard and bring laborers into the vineyard. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
The blessing of the Most Holy Trinity accompany you, the Father, and the Son.